I'm thinking back to the first time I heard you guys, because it was listening to this radio station before I even worked here.
Really?
And I called up the music director at the time, and I said, who is that? It was one of those moments, who is that? And it was not ready to go. It was the first time I heard the truth, so that was a good thing.
Thanks,
Lee. It's album number 6 is here. It's called Civilianaires. It's going to be out actually September the 14th, but it's in the can. Yeah. You guys must be really excited. It's always like kind of giving birth, isn't it?
Yeah.
Kind of.
Yeah.
It's every time is different. But I guess like giving birth. it was a long process, but we're really proud of it.
Yeah, good. The last time you guys put out something new was actually your greatest hits record. Had a couple of new songs on it, which was great. Mm-hmm. But you know, greatest hits records are always kind of that end of a chapter, kind of a turning point. There's a new episode on the other side. Did you go into that phase knowing that that was the case?
We had a little bit of an existential crisis, especially when it came to greatest hits time. We were like, we're a greatest hits band. It doesn't make sense.
How to get this late so early?
And we also just didn't really. Maybe humble to a fault, but we just didn't feel like it was even the right move. It was part of the contract, and we were like, okay. So we were already writing new songs, so we tacked on a few new tunes on that. But then we kind of went out of there like, oh crap! Like we just did like a greatest hits tour. Like that's something. And then so we kind of really put a lot more pressure on ourselves to really try to find something new and interesting and exciting for ourselves and hopefully for the fans with this new album.
So it was greatest hits, but you know, you think back to, I guess it was 12 years, 13 years earlier, tooling around in Antigonish with
emphasis on
where you had to go somewhere to pursue everything. Yeah. All of a sudden it was kind of like, okay, pack your bags, We're on the road, and where this leads, nobody knows.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, you don't get to do that too often in your life, but like when you're just leaving high school and you're 18 and 19 years old, is like that's the time when you can sort of like really throw caution to the wind. Not that you can't do that at any other point in your life, it's just easier then. We went and lived hand to mouth in a cheap rent home in Niagara Falls.
And we actually did live in Oshawa for a
And we
second.
Lived, yeah, we crashed in Oshawa. Jack's uncle lives here, Phil Siprek, and he used to let us crash. Again, we were like, you know, we would crash anywhere that had a bed, and we would jam anywhere, and we would play anywhere, and we would write all the time. And we were just out on an adventure and just bound together by our love of music. And no idea, just blind faith that it would lead somewhere, but no idea how to get there.
Yeah.
And then slowly things start to fall into place. You start to meet people, you start to do shows, and all of a sudden people start to introduce yourself and introduce themselves to us, like our manager and agent and stuff like that. So slowly you get your career together, and next thing you know, you're on that treadmill, and then you look back a decade later, and you're like, wow, we've been at this for a while.
Yeah, your original drummer, I was reading a story about him today when he decided to leave the band a little while ago, and he was sharing that exact same story about how the idea was to quit high school and just throw it at the wall and wait for something to stick, and wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was about as much logic that went into it. Yeah. I mean, now I look back, I almost get a freaking panic.
You crazy kids. I mean, you never tell your kids to do that. What did your family think?
They were, I don't know if they were thinking at all, but no offense to them. But I think they were kind of like, well, these guys are going to do this one way or the other. So either we can support them and they were always pretty, pretty cool with it. They were all big music fans. Yeah. And, you know, it wasn't like a cardinal sin to end up even just playing cover songs somewhere. It's like we knew lots of musicians, you know. It wasn't always about making it to a certain level of fame or fortune, which was always nice. We never had that kind of pressure because we knew all kinds of great musicians that are still out playing and they're just playing bars and doing their thing and it's fine. So they kind of had a good perspective on it in that sense, I think. Yeah. But at least our parents.
And they did see how serious we were with it. Yeah. Like, and I say that with aspiring bands or up and coming, you know, parents often ask you because their kids are teenagers and they want to pursue music and just work really hard on the right stuff, which is like playing great shows and writing songs. And I think that was always our ambition, was like, we worked hard at those things and everything else. Like the lifestyle is crazy and it remains crazy. You know, it's crazy for different reasons then than it is now. But like that part is just, it is what it is. If you can cope with it, you know, more power to you. Yeah. But if you focus your efforts on playing for people and putting on good shows and writing good songs, then you can't really go too far wrong. It's time well spent.
Music for East Coasters, though, is a different thing than it is for the rest of the country.
Absolutely.
I mean, music is ingrained in the culture.
That's a good
point. Played in the kitchens. Yeah. It's
good
played
point.
Everywhere. So to pursue it is almost like being a doctor.
Yeah,
maybe.
Maybe.
The money.
Yeah. I wouldn't go that far, but you were definitely, yeah, definitely had me up to doctor point. But it's like, you're absolutely right. It's more of a, it's a thing. People play music and it's respected and it's liked. And I always told the guys, like when we go down to the East Coast Music Awards, I'm like, you know, you can't have too much of an ego down there because the monitor guy's a better musician than you are. Like a lot of these guys have been playing since they were babies and they can sing like birds and they can just play the fiddle and they can sing folk music. And it doesn't have the same as star culture as, you know, that has evolved in like America and stuff with, around music. So there was always that with us too, where it was like, yeah, well, okay, so if you have to go play a little Scottish pub somewhere, Irish pub, so what? Go and do it well and have fun and enjoy it. And we certainly did a lot of that. We still do that when we go to some other territories and stuff. It's not like, oh my God, we haven't made it. There was never that kind of pressure because we're like, oh, as long as we can still kind of feed ourselves and you can get free beer if you play songs for 3 hours, that's pretty good. So like there was always those things too, which, I mean, I don't know if we'd like those. I mean, we probably need a little bit more now, but but at the time those were pretty good, ample rewards. It's like, yeah, we never had to pay for beer. That's one thing, something, you know? So anyway.
You guys moved to Hamilton recently. Is that?
I live there. Yeah.
You live there now.
Owen still lives downtown in Toronto.
Yeah, I still live in Toronto.
Myself and Jack, the two family men. We both have two kids.
Yeah.
Each, and I moved out there 4 years ago just to get into a bit of a different lifestyle environment. You know, I was living on Queen West until then, and it was nice to be out there. Now I have a backyard, and you know, driveway and all this stuff. It's hard to have in Toronto. So
it's really attracting a lot from the arts community.
It is. Yeah. It's a great, great town for the arts.
Toronto's really going to have to be careful because they're pricing all the artists out, and that's not good for any city. And Hamilton's picking up the slack. Like all the really interesting, you know, artistic people are going there because they can afford to keep pursuing their thing, and that's really important. And same with Oshawa. I mean, places like Oshawa, like places where it's cheaper to live, so people can come and do their thing. And then Toronto's just going to be inundated by corporate types because no one can afford millions of dollars for a house.
Yeah.
That's ridiculous.
But already you're hearing complaints about people who grew up in Hamilton are finding themselves being priced out now because
on
more and more
end.
People, especially people from Toronto, from the West End that can't afford to live there.
And even in the time since I've been there, you know, it's grown a lot.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I've been there for like 4.5 years, I guess. So it's grown a lot. And I hear that too from locals, but it's almost, it just seems like the inevitable effect of being that close to Toronto. Mm.
Yeah. So when you guys work together, do you meet halfway or how do you?
No, I always have to drive to Hamilton, but whatever.
We outnumber them now. There's more band members, original band members in Hamilton.
Yeah.
As long as you don't have to go during rush hour, everything's okay.
Well, that's the thing. Yeah. And it seems like there's no such thing as not rush hour anymore.
Yep.
So it's just all continuous rush hour.
Yeah. Let's talk about the new single. One thing I get out of hearing new music is, and specifically when I heard you guys for the first time, going back, is vibe and groove.
Mm-hmm.
And your new song, Vintage Love, is a completely different vibe and a completely different feel, a different groove.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And it was co-written by Max Kerman for Mark Hells.
Mm-hmm. Yep. It was a big concerted effort to shake things up for us and for, I mean, I was saying this earlier today too, it's like you know, we spent the first 10 years looking up to people and getting some of our heroes to produce us, like Gordy Johnson, Gord Sinclair, Jack Douglas, like guys that really know and that we look up to and respect and love their work. And in this record, we were kind of looking to the younger people because we were kind of like, now we're a little bit older. And we, like, you know, Max and Janangas hang out quite a bit in Hamilton. So Janangas started showing Max our demos and Max like, oh, you should do this, you should do that. And then Janangas said, well, why don't you come in and produce and help us out and see what we do. And I was in pretty constant contact with, and as is Janangas, with like some of the Glorious Sons guys and stuff, because we were starting to realize, like, you know, a lot of these younger bands are really doing really great, interesting stuff. And we just kind of wanted to change things for us, to keep it relevant for us and exciting and interesting, you know? So it is a different thing, but that was very much on purpose.
Yeah. Like, it was a bit of a long road to get to the record, as I alluded to earlier. Like, our last full length was 2014, and then we shook a lot of things up between now and then. Besides Sean leaving the band, we changed management, we changed record label, we changed agents in the States. A lot of moving parts changed in the last 4 years. So I think what we were searching around in the wilderness to figure out what the next thing was going to be creatively. And I feel like once we met with Derek Hoffman, who produced the record, we started coming up with stuff that excited us immediately. And like, Vintage Love is a good example of that. Like, it's fresh, it's new, it doesn't sound like anything we've ever done before. And I put that in the good category. Some fans don't always put that thing in the good category. But when I hear a band trying something they haven't done before, that excites me. I think that's a good thing.
It seems like, did you see yourself at the time hitting like a signpost, or is that something that you see now upon reflection with all those changes?
I think it was a bit of reflection. Mm-hmm. I think we were just like shaking things up in every department. And then at the same time, trying to land on our feet creatively mm-hmm. in a new situation. But I mean, again, I really feel, I know everybody says this about their latest work, but I really feel like it's a great record as a result. Maybe the chaos fed into the order of the album, because it is, in the end, it's a very good piece of work, in my opinion. You know? Yeah.
Well, it takes a long time to establish your own voice and find your own voice. And when you hit that spot where you think there has to be some change, there's a fine line between making that big step and then contriving a step. Was there any kind
that's
of...
That's a good point. I think that we always kind of go with our gut on these things, you know? And we did have a couple of stop and start moments making this record where we went into the studio and we did a few songs here and there. And we're just like, we just don't feel like, you know, going out right now. Like, we just don't feel like we're ready to go on tour. We don't feel like we're ready to put this out and be, like, excited. And then when we finally started to get that feeling, and it was November of 2017, and it was when we hooked up with Derek and we started putting everything together and writing some more material and getting it all going, that we were like, oh, I feel like doing this. I feel inspired. And that's, and when we get that feeling, we're like, okay, then we have to do this. So I think it wasn't contrived in that sense, you know, but it was definitely, we were searching. We didn't want to just go out and do another thing that we'd already kind of done and just keep going. We wanted to do something that shook us up, and for better or for worse, I think, you know.
I personally would have felt a little bit of anxiety, because in these days, you know, you can't rely on royalties to keep you floating.
No,
I mean, you have to work all the time.
Yeah.
So for you guys to be sitting around saying, okay, we're not going to go out there for a little while until we're ready again.
Yeah.
That's a big decision.
We've never completely gone away.
Yeah.
Yeah. Again, like, playing is our bread and butter. So we never completely go away. For one, we just love playing, and we love playing live shows. Whenever the band is like, you're not going to hear from us for 3 years, everything goes dark, we'll always show up and do something, because we love to play. And I mean, like, you wouldn't be able to, I mean, I think it would be the end of the band if we stopped playing for 3 straight years, you know, we'd just die from boredom, I think.
Yeah.
But,
Trews passed away from boredom.
I think what you mean by, like, not going out, you don't feel like going out and touring this particular new stuff.
Yeah.
You know, we'd still be out doing festivals in the summer and that kind of stuff. I think what you were trying to say is, like, you didn't feel like firing this out, this particular thing, and taking it on the road.
Yeah.
So are you in the middle of rehearsals right now?
Yeah. We just did one of yes 2 days ago. We're heading down east to do a show in Truro.
Mm-hmm.
Just an hour outside Antigonish, and then we're gonna go to Antigonish and kick off the
We're like doing the opening ceremonies of the Summer Olympic Special Olympic Summer Games.
Yeah.
I think it's
They're being held in Antigonish.
Yeah, so we're going to do the opening ceremonies for that. Mm-hmm. And then we got a bunch of GTA stuff. Like, we're playing Bala on the 5th of August, Key to Bala. We're doing a Jays tailgate in August.
Nice.
And we're doing the CNE on the 2nd.
Yes, I see
closing
that.
Closing night, I think, of the CNE. We're going to play the band shell.
Do you guys know Port Medway?
Mm-mm.
Port Medway, it's really close to Liverpool.
But, like, out of Liverpool,
Nova Scotia.
Oh, okay,
Yeah.
It's funny. Like,
we probably drove through it.
Must have. Yeah. No, we're Antigonish boys.
There's a few, there's a couple of things in Nova Scotia where, like, when you start going out towards Yarmouth and stuff, you kind of never really go out that way. I mean, we didn't really spend too much time that way.
No.
We always between Halifax and Antigonish and Cape Breton. So.
Interesting. Yeah, so, huge shoreline there. I've only been to Nova Scotia once, and I spent 2 weeks in Port Medway when I was a teenager. It's a little fishing town. It's off the beaten path.
Okay.
It was very, very quiet.
Yeah,
yes.
And, you know, for a 15, 16-year-old with raging hormones, it was really great to get back home and get on the GO train and go down to the CNE to see Buddy Rich.
Right.
But I'll tell you, man, I'd love to go back to Port Medway again and just be nice and slow.
We come from Antigonish, which it probably isn't that much bigger. It's a town of about 5,000. And those raging hormones have to go somewhere. That's what you start making music in a band for.
Yeah.
Living in a pre-internet small town where you just looking for something to do and you're no good at hockey.
Yeah.
You're good at playing music.
That's the definition of every Canadian band that ever started. You weren't good enough at hockey.
So the last time I saw you, I think it was at the Unison Jam 2 years ago, the Phoenix, and you guys opened up with the Yardbirds song, Shape of Things. Wow.
Yeah.
That was so good, and that is such a great song that just crosses the decades and still...
I love that. We've been covering that for years because we used to have like a couple cassette tapes in our original touring van. Mm-hmm. One of them was Jeff Beck's Truth. Yeah. So we wore that album right out, and we always wanted to cover that tune. And I think when we first started doing it, it was like playing at Jeff Healy's club, and Jeff Healy used to sit in with us and do it. And then when we went and opened for Big Sugar early on, Gordy was quite impressed with that cover, so we used to do it a lot. I love that. Great record. What an album.
Yeah. Guys, it's always great to have you along.
Thank you for having us, man.
It's great talking about
music.
Yeah, for sure. We'll see you at the Band Shell on September the 2nd. Always a great place. Always a free show. It's always jammed and everybody's in a great mood. Even though it's the end of summer, it's just
one last hurrah.
Such a great tradition.
Yeah. Love it.
Okay. Again, we'll see you soon.
Thanks, man.
Thank you. Cool. Civilianaires out September 14th.
All right.